Why don't we stand? Let's do our confession together. And I'm believing for this confession to work this year like it has every other year. I'm telling you, in abundance. Amen. So, Lord, I choose to obey your word, for as I dwell and walk in your presence, I shall not lack. Poverty be far from me and my household, in Jesus' name. I will walk in your blessings, Lord. I will rise above all that hell has to offer and accept heaven's best here on earth. Everything I set my hands to will prosper because I make you my dwelling place. You are my refuge and my fortress. Thank you, Lord, for your provision. I accept it by faith, fully expecting your blessings in every area of my life. For wherever your presence is, there is no lack. Therefore, Lord, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for abundant harvest, health, jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, scholarships and grants, inventions with royalties, finding money, bills paid off, bills decreased, blessings and increase, bargains and child support. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our financial needs, that we may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah and amen. Yeah, this is the month of grace. Davis thought we might be going to do grace and mercy together, but I'm thinking that there's probably enough material for grace alone for us to do four Sundays in January. I look back last year in January. Anybody remember what January month was last year? Virtue. I look back. I broke out a new notebook this week. I had the other one filled up. And so I look back this morning. Virtue, miraculous energy or power. I remember we had some good sermons that come out of that, because virtue is one of those words that we thought we knew and we didn't really know it as well as what we thought that we did. And so it made it, and the very first sermon I preached last year was about the freebies. I shared with you some of the freebies that come because of the miraculous energy or power that God gives us, the abilities that we can have. But we have chosen grace for this month. When I thought about that, I thought about it because of all the freebies that we have from God. Grace is the ultimate freebie. There's not anything that's better than the grace. I just want you to know that. And in fact, everything else that comes from God comes from under grace. This one freebie, because, you know, one of the definitions of that you've heard probably most of your life is unmerited favor. Because grace is something that we don't earn, we can't pay for it. It's just God's love bestowed towards us, that His grace is there. It is literally the ultimate freebie, and by it, all other freebies exist. So when we talk about healing, or we preach on deliverance, or we preach on prosperity, it doesn't matter what we preach on. When we talk about the goodness of God, we're talking about the things that God gives us, the freebies that come. When I preached a few weeks ago, taught about the nine ways that God wants to bless you, all of it comes out from underneath grace. And I can remember well preaching, I probably preached it a couple times over the years, and I mention it more than that, but I remember that God taught me way back yonder, I don't remember what you called him, but grace to me was God's riches at Christ's expense. I don't remember where I learned it, if Holy Spirit put that in my spirit years and years ago, but if you look at G-R-A-C-E, you have God's riches at Christ's expense, because grace is all about Jesus Christ. Now, you may or may not be theologically intelligent enough to know this yet, and that doesn't matter because it's not important, but the first couple thousand years of man's existence, it was a free will basis with God. All people were free to serve God or not, and of course, most people didn't freely serve God. In fact, they got so bad that God had to destroy them. And then along come the law. And for the next couple thousand years, give or take, you know, a few years, it was about the law. God gave the law to Moses up on Mount Sinai, Ten Commandments, and then all that stuff that's written in Deuteronomy that Brother Mike's reading about right now, or will be pretty shortly. But then Jesus came, amen? And aren't we glad for Jesus? We are no longer under the law, but we are under grace. It's what it is called is a dispensation. And that just means an allotted time. God has an allotted time for the grace to be over the world. And thank God that we live under this dispensation. Amen. Just thank God that you're a part right now of something that was totally free. And when I preached this long, long time ago, I called it an umbrella. It was one of those type lessons where I could use a prop. I could have had me a nice big umbrella. Could have had one today. It would have got your attention and you'd have, you know, you can form that picture in your head, even though I don't have one over my head. Might have one around here somewhere, don't know. But, and the thing about grace is I preach that because as long as I choose, you know, if it were raining today outside and I had an umbrella in my hand, then it would be my choice to open the umbrella and to walk under it to get to where I'm going. And while I'd be walking under that as my choice, it would keep me from the rain that was falling from up above. Now, I've learned over the years that sometimes the rain splashes and you kind of get some side effects from it. How many of you know now by having been a Christian for a while that there are still some side effects that come from all the things that are in the world around us? But literally, we are protected under this umbrella of grace. And if I want to stay under it, all right, it protects me. But if I want to remove myself from under that umbrella, I would get wet, so to speak, in the world. But spiritually speaking, I'm going to get worse than wet. I'm going to get spiritually wet. All right? In fact, some people spiritually drown when they get out from underneath an umbrella of grace. Now, no matter who we are today, know this. God's umbrella of grace is open. And all you've got to do is walk right under it. All you got to do is step under where it's at. All you got to do is, literally, that's what an altar, old-fashioned altars are about. In our church, it's about an opportunity for us to say, God, I want to experience your grace. I want to experience your protection. I want to experience all the things that come from you that you openly make available. So many times we do not grasp, so many people don't, the fact that Jesus said, I'm come that you might have life and have it more abundant. Abundant life is not found outside the umbrella of grace. Abundant life is found when we find ourselves and make that choice that I'm going to live there. In fact, if I get right under the very middle of it, I can protect myself from more of it if I'm trying to wean myself away or walk on the edges. You know, we talk about living in the, it's either right or wrong. There's no gray area. It's either black or white. And some people want to hold the umbrella out here, and when it gets too hard for them, then they'll pull it back over, and then when things are going good, they want to stick it back out here. Now, a lot of us in this room have lived that kind of life. When things were going really rough, really tough, then we were pulling on that umbrella, trying to get under it good and trying to get back in favor with God. And then when everything's going well, what do? We stick that thing back out here. And when it's going really good, sometimes we think that, you know, it's not raining at all. And we close the thing up and use it for a prop or something. Well, the truth is we better keep it open at all times in our life. And we need to be very aware. So it'd probably be good that we spend at least a month talking about grace, how good that God is, how good that the riches in glory through Christ Jesus, because he's promised to supply all of them. Remember that? And it's all according to Christ, what Jesus Christ did for us when he came to the earth, born as a virgin, lived those 30 plus years, ministered on the earth 3.5 years, teaching us, leaving the word, inspiring men to write the New Testament that goes along with the Old Testament. I'm telling you, Christ done everything that needed to be done. And he accomplished it in a way in which no matter what that we're looking for, what we need, where we hope to be, what we hope for 2021, I'm telling you that all our hopes can be found under an umbrella of grace. I'm telling you today that grace takes us somewhere, and that's where a sermon will come from in a few minutes, because the title of our sermon today is going to be Gracious and Faithful. Because not only is God gracious, but he's also faithful. And not only does he want us to live by grace, but he also wants us to live in faith. And you can't do one without the other. If we're going to be under this umbrella of grace, then we're going to walk by faith and not just by sight. So you can keep the thought, you know, grace means unmerited favors. It's just there. It's the ultimate freebie. God's got things waiting for me that I had no clue that's there, exceedingly abundantly above anything that I could do, say, or ask, or even think. It's, wouldn't it be awesome? Maybe we ought to be praying about visions and dreams more than what we do, because a lot of people are prophetic, and some of you are and don't even know it. And God would like to reveal some things. When you get over in the New Testament, you'll find out that God reveals things through the presence of the Holy Spirit. He'll show you some things future-wise just to draw you closer under the umbrella of grace to help you believe for things that you've had a hard time believing for in the past. So let me tell you as pastor that no matter what you need in your life, God's got it. He's got it available. He made it available. It's up to you to choose to stay under grace, and then it's up to you to access that when you get there. Amen. So as long as we live, long as we're alive, as long as the Lord doesn't return and take the church out of here, we're going to be under grace. And my belief is that most of us in this room, we're going to be here for a while. So the question would be, and it might be your question today, how do we access grace? How do we access it? Brother Dale, we're under it. You say it's available. Abundant life is made available to me. That means more than what's common, generally speaking. Well, in 2 Corinthians 12, let me give you three or four scriptures, and then we'll get on into the sermon. He said that his grace is sufficient. And he said unto me, look at that first line, my grace is sufficient for thee. So if you have any questions about whether God's got enough grace to go around, just underline that in your Bible, because the Bible says that his grace is sufficient. That means there's more than enough. If we were feeding a meal and I said we've got enough food to feed everybody, that means that it's sufficient for everybody. God's grace is sufficient for every one of us here. You may need more of it than I do, or I may need more of it than you do. It doesn't matter. I may eat four chicken legs and you may eat two, but there's six chicken legs, so we're both covered, right? His grace is sufficient for all of our needs. And then he added this, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. All right? Well, we are all aware that on any scale, we're weak. We have some weak areas of our life. But where we're weak, grace can make us strong, because his grace is sufficient. His strength becomes my strength under grace. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. All right? So it doesn't matter what we're going to experience this year. Doesn't matter what we're going to face. I honestly don't believe me and Susan's going to go through battles this year like we did last year. We're going to pray harder, work harder, live better, trust God more. And I pray that becomes part of what you got in your mind and in your heart for this year. But we still know that his grace is sufficient. And when we look back over 2020, how many of us today can say, you know what? His grace was sufficient. He got me through. I didn't run out of toilet paper. Okay? I didn't run out of food. I wasn't kicked out of my house. I didn't lose my car. I still got my job. You know, I'm telling you, we can make a list where his grace was sufficient, and you may or may not have realized at the time that God was looking out for you, but let me tell you, God's been looking out for you. God's been watching your back. God's been trying to help you. God's been trying to do good things for you, and God wants to do way more in this year than he did last year, and last year he took care of us. And so thank you, God. Everybody just turn to your neighbor and say, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord that he took care of us. Amen. And then the next scripture I want us to look at is Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. And there it talks about how that every one of us is given grace. Look at there. But unto every one of us is given grace. Remember, the ultimate freebie. It's given us according to the measure of the gift of Christ. So, now think about that for a minute, because there's just a little common sense that goes with this scripture. The closer I get to God through Jesus, the better my relationship is with Jesus, the bigger my gift of grace is. The more I can access what God's got for me. That's why sometimes we look at people and we think, wow, man, God's really been good to them. Yeah, you know why he's been so good to them? Because they have better relationship than what I do. You look at a ministry that's excelled, and some of my favorites, you know, Charles Capps, we listened to him this morning, he excelled. Why? Because he got close to God. And he accessed more grace than what I have in my life. Joyce Myers, there's a lot of different ones that it's very noticeable that they've been, that God has been very good to them in their lifetime. And it's because they served him better than I've served him. That's why this year is going to be the year of the servant. And we're going to line up so that God can be as good to us as what he wants to be to us. And we can get under this grace. In fact, there's a scripture Paul wrote somewhere that said, more grace, more grace. Amen. So we're going to access more grace. I don't know what we accessed last year. Maybe we got us a gallon full. Well, if I got a gallon full last year, I want 5 gallon full. Amen. So let's just multiply that. Whatever, let's just say, hey, you know what, God, I think I'm interested in 10 times more grace for 2021 than what we had last year. And that means I'm going to live 10 times better than hallelujah, right? That means that 10 times stronger, 10 times more aware of what's going on. Whatever that it means, I want it. And it's a freebie. It's the ultimate freebie. It's given to us according to the measure of the gift of Christ. And then there's a very popular one, you back up, Ephesians 2 verse 8, that I share a lot with you because it's so important for you to always to remember. But it's by grace that we are saved through faith. The grace is there. Your salvation has already been made available. Amen. Your healing's already been made available. Your prosperity is already there. You know, if I told you today that there was a bank account and a bank at Dexter and there were two names on it, God's name was on it and your name was on it, and all you got to do was go there and write a check off of it for whatever amount that you wanted, how many of you would go to Dexter tomorrow with a paper and a pen and say, give me a check. I want to access this account. What we don't realize is that God's opened an account for us under grace, amen, that's way better than any kind of money account that could be opened in a bank at Dexter or anywhere else. We just cannot get a clue of how good that grace is because we haven't got a clue yet how good that God is. I'm telling you, there is nothing that God will withhold from his children if we can believe him for it. Not one thing. But we've got to learn how to access it. Well, how do I access it? Right there was the answer. For by grace am I saved through faith. Faith is our access to grace. It's how we get there. And that not of ourselves, it is what? I love this word gift. And I stressed it a lot the last month or so because, listen, God wants you to understand these things are freebies. These things are yours for the taking. These are yours for you to receive, but we have to receive by faith. We got to know it. Faith is the key, all right? So that's why I entitled it Gracious and Faithful, because the grace is there, is the faith there. So I want to, and here's, in fact, what I'm going to preach with you to you today, I preached in part in 1994. That's how old this part of this sermon is. And when I preached it the first time, I wanted the people, I said, think about what you got to work with. What do you have to work with? If you were to go out and plant a garden, you would think, what do I have to work with? Do I have any seed? Do I have a hoe? Do I have a garden tiller? Do I have any experience? Do I have a tomato? You'd think about all the things that it would take for you to grow a garden. Well, I want you to think about this. All you got to have to access grace under this umbrella is faith. That's all you got to have. So it's not like you don't have what it takes. Grace is the storehouse and faith is the key. You hear me? Grace is the storehouse and it's full. And in Malachi, he said he'd open up the windows of heaven, didn't he? And pour out what? Blessings that you could not contain. I preached to you out of Deuteronomy where that he wanted to bless you and he said they will come upon you and overtake you. When we begin to live by faith and trust God and believe God and use our access to grace, all right, God's fixing to do a work. He's fixing to bless some people. He's fixing to take care of some problems. He's fixing to heal some hurts. He's fixing to mend some cracked pots. Amen. This is the year of the crackpots, serving crackpots, serving God, winning souls, vessels of honor and not dishonor. Amen. So what does faith do for me? Number one, faith provides. Faith provides. God's got all this provision, and faith is my access to it. Now, we don't have a lock on our refrigerator, but there's one in the teen room that's got a hasp on it. And the reason is because it came out of the teen center that we had in Bernie years ago. And so you had to put a little padlock on the door because if there was not a lock on it, everybody had access to the refrigerator. If they had access to the refrigerator, they had access to miniature pizzas and other things that we kept hid in there. So we put a lock on it. Well, God's got, he's got a spiritual lock on grace that's only accessed by faith, which is the key. And all our provision, how many of you know who he is? Jehovah what? Jireh. My God is provider of all my needs. How does he provide for me? He provides for me and for you under grace. And he gives us the faith to be able to believe God to receive whatever it is that we need. So now I got grace that's been made available to me. It's like it's here, come and get it. Can't you just hear God saying, come and get it? Wouldn't it be an awesome day if everybody in this room, the Holy Spirit would just speak to you and say, come and get it. When Susan cooked a meal for us yesterday, she calls and says, it's ready. She was saying, come and get it. Yeah. And if you don't come and get it, she says she'll throw it away, but she doesn't. You know what? God's not throwing it away either. He's telling us to come and get it. There's no telling what is laid up in store for some of you, for all of us in this room. And God's been trying to get us to come and get it forever and ever. In fact, he wanted, I'll just say this. He wanted you guys right here and the rest of our church family that's not here, he wanted you to come and get it. And you know why I know that? Because he told me and Susan to come to Bernie and open a church and preach faith and teach faith so that you could learn how to access grace. And for 28 years, Davis says, we've been teaching faith, preaching faith, and I tell you every week to walk by faith and not by sight, because you, if you're going to access grace and get what God's got for you, that's how you do it. You do it by faith. And the first thing that it does, it provides for us. Amen. It provides. The second thing is it protects us. Faith protects us. You cannot put on your armor every day without taking up the what? Shield of faith. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 16. You take up the shield of faith. The Bible says it quenches every fiery dart of the enemy. How many of you are tired of being punctured by the enemy? He's been after me my whole life, and he throws me this curveball and shoots at me with this. And you know what? You get tired of it. Well, faith quenches fiery darts. It's a protector of us. I can believe God and I don't have to put up with the devil. I can recognize the devil's attack. Holy Spirit can tell me, shield yourself. When I taught faith from in the beginning, I used a Gideon's New Testament. How many of you ever had one of them? A Gideon New Testament. They were red in my day, way back there. When you got them in the fifth grade, I believe it was, doesn't matter. They had little white ones for nurses. They had them all. And a lot of people's faith, that's how big that it is. I'm telling you, that's how big it is. And if that's all the word that you got in you. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Your faith is, the level of your faith is determined at this moment by how much of this that you've got inside of you. Now, if you've been saved as long as me and Susan have, we outgrow that Gideon New Testament. In fact, this Bible is about as big as one I've got. But the truth be known, listen, God wants us to have so much word in us that we can have a Roman shield, and they could plant a Roman shield and hunker under it, and it protected their whole front. And he said, you ain't got to worry about your back. I've got your back. You protect what you can see, and I'll protect you where you can't see. It's my faith that protects me, and it's your faith that protects you. And if we want to be protected next year, what are we going to do? We're going to stay in the Word. All right, we got some that's already determined. We're going to read more, study God's Word more. We're going to learn more. And I'm telling you, the more you learn, the bigger your faith gets. Amen. It protects. Number three is faith promotes. Faith promotes. When you know why Joshua got promoted to leader of God's people? Because him and Caleb believed God. Their faith promoted them over the whole Israeli people in that day. It's been doing it for centuries, for years. God promotes faith. But you know what I say about faith? Faith is like a billboard. When you walk by faith and you, it has an expression and it's visible to other people, it's like a billboard. They see it and they think, there's that or there's that. Well, when they see you and me, they need to see our faith. The Bible said in James chapter 2, verse 17, that faith without works is dead, being alone. Do you know that works is a visible thing? So your faith becomes visible to other people. So it's promoting God's word, whether you're aware of it or not. People begin to see what's going on in your life and then see that it's different than what's going on in their life. And so, again, they're reading us. We are the only Bible that many people ever see and the only Bible that many people ever read. And so my faith becomes a visible proof that God indwells my heart to other people. And that promotes what? That promotes God. Who are we here to lift up? God. Who are we here to worship? God. Who are we here to give praise to? God. Who are we here to honor with all our heart, soul, body, and strength, even as we love them? It's God. So we need to have faith that promotes God. Amen? All right. And number four on this list is faith praises. Faith praises. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says that faith is what? The evidence of the thing that's not seen. All right? It's the evidence of that which is not seen. I have faith, I see it. I see it. I know by faith, I see it. It doesn't have to be visible to anybody else because I saw it. If I see what God's doing, then that all of a sudden, I change within me. I become, all right, the person who has joy. What does joy do for us? The joy of the Lord is our strength. Now, I see what God's doing. I know that it's coming my way. I know that God's taking care of this. I'm not worried about this debt, this bill. I'm not worried about catching COVID. I've put aside fear because faith that praises has no fear. And what it does have is strength because it produces joy, and joy allows me to praise God. Thank you, Lord, for taking care of our needs. Thank you, Lord, for being there for us. Thank you, God, for making a way when I didn't know there was a way. Thank you, Lord, for saving my children or saving my spouse or whoever it may be. You see it in advance. You know it's going to happen, and you begin to praise God for it. Amen. And the more you praise God for it, the faster that it's going to happen. And here we go. What is it that God wants for us under this umbrella? He's got grace for your lost husband. He's got grace for your lost children. He's got grace for your lost friend. The grace is there. We're going to access it for them, all right, by our faith. We win our husbands by our good conversation. Remember that one in 1 Peter? Yeah, it's what's going to happen. You remember something? Let's talk about this one in Mark. Chapter number two. There were four men who had a friend who was paralyzed. You remember that? And these four men said, you know what? We hear that man Jesus down there can heal. Why don't we pick up his bed, take him down there? So his four friends took up his bed and they walked down there. Remember the story? True story, I believe with all my heart. And when they got down there, there was such a crowd they couldn't get them in there. And so one of them said, I know what we'll do. What are we going to do? By faith, we're going to climb up on the roof. And they carried him up on the roof. And by faith, they tore open the roof. And by faith, they let him down inside at Jesus' feet. And by faith of four men, this man didn't just get healed. He got saved first. And these four men are up there, and it provided what? Look at the list, even so far. It provided means for healing. It protected them from the people around them. It promoted God because people were looking at their faith. And now all of a sudden, we've got the praise of God because their faith praised God before it even happened. They were praising God, or they wouldn't have climbed up the roof. They wouldn't have tore open the roof, and they wouldn't have let them down inside the building. And here's God's grace. Nobody could see it, but that umbrella of grace was over that whole town, over that whole situation, over those four men, over their buddy. Faith and grace, what a combination. Amen. All right, that's praises. Look at number five, faith that perfects. Faith perfects us. As it grows, okay, it changes us. Now, you may be a brand new convert, just got right with God. Maybe, you know, and your faith is not stout yet. It's not strong. Do you know what it will become? Baby faith turns into man faith, turns into woman faith. Because God's word begins to perfect us. That means it begins to remove the flaws that keep us in a state in which God doesn't like. And the more that it perfects us, the stronger we get, the better that we become. What did Paul say? When I was a boy, I spake as a boy. I acted like a boy. I treated people like a boy. He goes through the whole gamut. But when he became a man, he said, what? I put away. When faith begins to perfect me, I begin to put away with the foolishness. I put away with the bad confessions. I put away with looking in the mirror and saying, I'm fat. I put away looking in my closet and saying, I don't have anything to wear. I ain't got nothing to wear. And you got so many clothes, you can't get them in the closet. Faith begins to perfect us. We begin to see truth. In perfection comes truth, because the perfect one is truth. And so instead of seeing things in a way in which they are not, we see the truth in the things that we see. And the first thing that got perfected was our spirit, where Holy Spirit dwells. And then all of a sudden our mind begins to be affected by our spirit. The word works down in here to change us up here. And we get a mind that becomes perfected and doesn't think things that it shouldn't think. It doesn't take us places that we're not supposed to go. And it doesn't say things that we do not need to say. When you clean up your speech, you know, we haven't taught you this well lately. Listen, you listen to what you say, and when you hear what you're saying and the foolishness that's within it, and you put an end to it, you begin to change your life. Your life changes quick. Amen. I love that. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, the Bible says that we grow in grace and knowledge. So as I'm growing in grace, all right, I'm growing in knowledge, and knowledge is where my faith comes from. So I'm growing in faith. It's perfecting me. Number 6 on our list is faith empowers me. It produces a confidence within me that says, I can do that. I can do that. All those years we spent saying, I can't do that. I don't believe I'm your man. Lord, you better get somebody else. Oh, that's not my calling. All right. Boy, I can't get up in that pulpit and give my testimony. I might cry. All of a sudden, we go from that I can't person to I become that I can person, because I'm being empowered by faith. Faith causes you to step out. I'll never forget that movie where Raiders of the Lost Ark, and he's got to cross that chasm. I think that was the movie, okay? It was one of them. And there was nothing there that was visible. Remember that? Not a thing that was there. Deep gully. Is there any way that I would have stepped out over that? Only by faith. I never forgot that illustration, because there are times in our life where we've got to step. It's a blind faith. It's believing God, trusting Him. Close your eyes if you have to. Don't look, but take the step. Be empowered by what God's word says. By believing God, you have access to grace, and under that grace was His bridge. And with every step that He took, the bridge completed. Mm-hmm. Long time ago, Susan and I took a couple big steps of faith. It's a good thing we were learning it and teaching it, because if we had to go back and do it all over again, I don't know. Yeah, we would have, because we did then, right? And it wasn't, you know, that I think I can, like the little engine who thought he could. It's I can, we can. And it goes from being I can to a we did. See, that's our testimony. Not only can I, but we did. It's not just you, it's you and God. It's God's word working in you, empowering you, giving you the ability to access grace. Because whatever that it is that God's asking from you that you need to be empowered to do, it's in that grace. It's already there. He's already taken care of it. Amen? So it don't matter what it is. This week, one of you, you're going to have a little talk with God, and God's going to say, well, you didn't get up there last week. What are you going to do this week?
Let me just come up right now. Just a minute.
All right, just come on there. Come on. She's feeling empowered.
All right, so I thought of this.
this morning. Yeah, back me up.
I got you.
And here you preached the whole thing, and I thought, no, they're all these. You hear me talk all the time, but let me just tell you how good God is, okay? I need a microphone.
Yeah, you do.
I'll get yours, David. Sorry.
He don't care.
So I just want to tell you, back in August the 14th, when Dale was sitting there and he didn't feel good, and we'd just already been through the surgery, and I turned around. I got to tell you, I turned around, and there he was with all this black GI blood coming up out of him, and here I'm kind of on his back, and immediately I thought, oh, my God, what is going on? And fear absolutely took over. It just absolutely took me over. And it lasted for about 2 seconds. And I have to tell you this because for 44 years, of course, we just come into 45 now, but for 44 years, he has covered my hind end. He's put that umbrella of grace up over me. And I've got right up in here just like this. You with me? Mm-hmm. And so I just walked along with Dale and with God, and he had me. But that time, my husband was sitting there, and he was out of it, and he was going to die if I didn't do something. And so that's when I got my umbrella of grace, and I popped it up, and I put it over him and me, and I took my authority, and I told the devil, even though I didn't feel like it, because I had fear. But when the Lord empowers you, what is that scripture that you just read? In my weakness, I am made strong. And I got up on him and I pulled him up, and he's dead weight. And I pulled him over, and that blood started pouring out of him. And he come back to himself. And the whole time I was telling the devil, you are not taking this man of God. You will not kill him. He's going to live and not die.
And declare the works of the Lord.
You take your hands off of him. You let him go right now. He's going to live. You're going to be all right, baby. You're going to be all right. And you know what? It was a fight. And are we able to fight?
Amen.
Yes, we are.
Under
we are
grace.
Able because of all these things. He just preached all that. And I thought of this morning. I thought, I don't want to get up and tell that. I don't want to do that again. But I'm telling you, I'm under that umbrella of grace. God has us. And sometimes we just need to open our mouths and declare it. And let it empower us. So that we can do the works of God, right?
Amen.
If I hadn't done that, he wouldn't be here. Things would have been completely different.
That's right.
But it wasn't God's time.
Nope.
The devil just snuck in and tried to take him out and take all of this out. We ain't going to have it in Jesus'
name. Amen. Here, babies, your glasses. She don't need them now. Well, we know who was supposed to get up here today, don't we? Amen. So, Brandon, you're off the hook for today. Okay. It empowers.
It does.
It's there, made available, ready to be accessed, all right, whenever.
Right.
And number 7 is faith proves, all right? It proves God's existence, and it proves it to you first. How many times do we struggle thinking, am I really saved? Does God really love me? Is God going to take care of me? Is God there to get me through this? We've all questioned God in our lifetime, every one of us. And we make mistakes and we think God doesn't love me. But let me tell you, your faith, all right, under this umbrella, it'll prove to you yourself. God will answer your prayer. God will take care of you. God will meet your need. That's why Rose got up here and testified. That's why Michelle testified. That's why Susan testified, because God proved himself to Rose, and he proved himself to Susan, and he's proved himself to me, and he'll prove himself to you. And when he proves himself to you, all right, he'll prove himself through you to other people. And people need to know how good God is, how real that he is, and how he can get us through whatever situation that we're ever going to get in. Amen. This is going to be a great year. But you know why it's going to be a great year? Because we're going to access grace through faith by believing God and trusting him. Amen.
Every tribe, every tongue, every heart will sing. Every knee will
All right, let's be blessed before we get gone. I got my blessing crew up here. One of these days, my little one will be big enough to come up and help us too. Amen. All right, you got your hands up. We've been doing this for a long time. Deuteronomy 20, verse 3 and 4. God said this. God said, listen up, children. As you approach each day your battles, don't let your hearts faint. Fear not, do not tremble, neither be afraid. For the Lord our God is He that goes with us to fight for us against all of our enemies, to keep us safe. And here's the high priest's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes His face to shine upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord lifts up His countenance upon you and gives you His peace. Amen.